Today I'll talk about leading praise and worship and prayer, and also not just that, but also preaching and sharing and everything. I'm trying to find out what is different about the way I teach this. I'm looking at everything from God's perspective. For instance, I talk about God is serving us. He is standing in front of us and behind us. He's laying His hand on us so we can come to God with freedom and faith. Yes, He will come to bless us. Actually, the Bible is full of Bible verses like that, that He has come to bless us. So we don't have to say, God, where are you? God, come quickly. Please help me. I need your help. Now, it's not wrong to say that, but I'm saying we can say something like, I know, before I pray, you know my need. That's what Jesus said. You know, the Bible is full of a description of God's work from His perspective. But it's very common for people to think of God or other things or praise and worship from man's perspective. For instance, when people pray, they'll say, Lord, I'm in pain, please help me. Oh, I have peace, please help me. Please provide for me. So that's thinking from man's perspective. And what happened is, then you say, Lord, I'm overwhelmed by problems. I have too many problems. It's too hard to overcome the problems. That way, people would lose faith. But what I've taught so far is like this. The Bible is full of description of what God has done to the Israelites, how He led the Israelites out of Egypt. God has a plan to do it, to save them. And then in the New Testament time, that God, according to His plan, sent Jesus Christ to die for us. And then talk about how, if God has not spared His Son to give His Son to us, He will also give us all things. That is looking from God's perspective. And also when Jesus talked about, don't worry, you look at the lilies, God will provide for them. And the sparrows, God will provide for them. Therefore, He will also provide for you. Because Jesus sees the heavenly perspective. And when Pontius Pilate said to Him, don't you know that I have authority to crucify you and to set you free? But Jesus said, if it is not the authority given to you from above, you can do nothing. So Jesus has full confidence that everything done to Him is with the permission of God, that God permits that happen, actually, to fulfill God's plan of salvation. Therefore, Jesus is not afraid. Now, He had to struggle in Gethsemane. Because, why? Because he knew that He's going to face the anger of God, the curse of God, the separation from God. And He knew that, you know, because He has been with God forever, God the Father forever, the unity is so strong. So when Jesus was in Gethsemane, He knew that He's going to face a separation from God. And to Him, this is unbearable. It's unthinkable. It's not the pain or death that He's afraid of. You can see that on the cross, He was not afraid of death. He said to the Father, Father, I commit to you my spirit. So He was not afraid of dying. And when He was up on the cross, He did not say, ouch, ooh, it's painful, ooh. He didn't say that. He was praying for the people. So why was Jesus in such pain in Gethsemane? Because He was afraid to face the penalty, the anger of God, the curse of God, all the curse on human mankind is poured upon Him. But when He was facing Pontius Pilate, He was not afraid. He knew that without God's permission, nothing can happen to Him. So He looked at His life, what's going to happen to Him, crucifixion, from God's perspective. And God has moved my heart. I thank God. It's not because of me. It's not my own ability. It's God teaching me to look at things from God's perspective. That God has taught me. As I said, when I experienced the Holy Spirit, it was when I was weak. I was not strong to experience the Holy Spirit. It's God chose me to let me experience the Holy Spirit powerfully, experience His love. And then when I experienced His love, I was overwhelmed by His love. I said, I didn't realize I could have that close relationship with God when that evangelist laid hand on me. I felt a great love flowing into my heart. I said, this is wonderful that I can experience the love of God like that. And then I started to think of everything God has done. God, you know, can come to me like that. And when I pray, I can feel the power going through me. When I cry to Jesus, I felt joy and peace and power and love. Later, I experienced the love of God when I cried to God. I said, this is great. And then I saw that God was continually blessing me. And He wants to bless you too. So I started to look at the love of God, the grace of God, the plan of God, all the work of God. And so when I read the Bible, I read from God's perspective. When I preach, you notice, when I teach, when I lead worship, I always talk about everything from God's perspective. For instance, I will lead worship like this. The Lord is right here. He wants to bless us. Open our heart, and He's willing to pour the blessing into our heart. He's standing in front of us and behind us. He has made up His mind to bless us. He's laying His hand on us so we can come to Him with confidence. He's happy to bless us. So this is all from the perspective of God. And God has a wonderful plan in our life. He's going to use our life mightily. For high as the heaven is above the earth, so great is His way, His plans for us, that His ideas, His plans, is so great above the human thought or the human plan. So when we look at things like this, then we say, all humans, including myself, you know, if we think of things on earth, think of godly things, a lot of times we say, oh, I have to build a church. That's a lot of work. Oh, how can I grow the church? How can I help the church to grow? How do I lead worship? How do I bring people to God's presence? It's always thinking from God's, from people's perspective, and it becomes difficult. But if we think from God's perspective, God has chosen to use us, and His plan is written in heaven. It's written in heaven. He has a wonderful plan in Psalm 139, verses 16 to 18. It talks about, before one of the days of my life has come to me, that You already have written it in Your book. That, O Lord, Your thought for me is so beautiful, that all the thoughts of God is so beautiful. So the Bible talks about from God's perspective, He has a wonderful plan. Therefore, I don't have to worry about what to do next. Whether I should go to this country or that country, or what method to use, because God will open the way. God will use people and environment and different things, and also the move in my heart to guide me where to go and where not to go. He has a plan, so I don't have to worry. You understand what I'm talking about? In the prayer and worship, in the preaching, in the teaching, in the thinking about difficulties. For instance, some of you are facing, you know, job problem, having no job, trying to find a job, and you worry. But if you look at it from God's perspective, God has a plan written in heaven already for you. But people say, that's too much, too hard to believe. But if you think of it like this, that we have experienced God, right? As the Bible promised, we have experienced His love, His power, His joy, His comfort. It's all according to the Word of God. So what God has promised, He has done. And He said, you know, whether you go to the left or right, you'll hear a voice behind you telling you, this is the way, go in it. So God said that, and God really does it. God really speaks to our heart to guide us. So what God has promised, He continues to do. And then He also said, when the Holy Spirit comes, it will bring conviction to people. That people will be convicted of their sins, and we find this true. So we find that what God has promised always comes true. And then also, a lot of people hear God's voice or hear how God guides us. So we find that God's promises are true and will come true. So when we face life, If we learn not to look at life from man's perspective, if you look at life on earth, you'll be saying, oh, it's so difficult. There's so many difficulties. It's too hard. I have no money. I have no resource. And then we'll be afraid. But if you believe that, far as the heaven is above the earth, so great is His way, His thoughts, above our ways and our thoughts. That His way is so perfect that He has a plan for us. So what we want to do when we lead worship or lead prayer, we want to say things like this. We don't just say, let's trust in the Lord. Let's call upon His name and let's believe in Him. Now this is from man's perspective what we do. But we can say it like this. Oh Lord, you see our needs. You know our needs. And you have a perfect plan. And you want to fulfill this plan in our lives. When we trust in you and follow you, then the plan will come true. When we seek first the kingdom of God and your righteousness, and all these things will be given to you, because everything is in your authority. You have the authority to give us anything. Therefore, I don't have to be afraid. Now, I hope you learned this. Because once you learn this, when you lead praise and worship, will be very, very different. Let me quote you some Bible verses that you can write down to help us to believe that everything is in God's hand. In Psalm 24, verse 1, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. So it says here, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it belongs to the Lord. The first thing, everything belongs to the Lord. That God is in control. Satan is not in control. Satan tried to steal from people, but if we have Jesus, everything go back to us. Everything belongs to God. That's the first Bible verse. And then John 19:11, which I quoted earlier, that Jesus said to Pontius Pilate, you would have no power over me if it were not given to you from above. That people has no authority over us. They cannot hurt us if we follow God. If we don't let them hurt us. If they say negative things, we don't have to let it stay in our mind. When they say negative things, it's their problem. It's their sin. So every day, we'll hear from people and actually from Satan. Satan will speak through people and say, you're no good, you're no use. This is from Satan. But you also have the Word of God, the promises of God, and also from godly people who will talk to you and encourage you that you are loved by God. God is a wonderful plan. But a lot of people will listen to Satan's voice. To listen to people's sinful voice. And that's why we are hurt. But you say, whatever he says is not going to change my life. Whatever he says, it's just like Satan. You know, you think about this. Someone went to heaven and he said, Satan is so small. He keeps talking very loudly. As if he has authority. But all this, what he said, are lies. But when God speaks, there is authority. So I hope that you believe that. God has authority. God has authority over everything. God is in control of everything. And so nobody can do anything against God's will except you. You can stop God's will in your life. If you let God control your life, if you let God control your life, nobody can stop you. But if you fear, you worry, when you sin, then you stop God's work in your life.
Hallelujah.
And then another verse, Colossians 1:16. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or authorities, all things were created by him and for him. Now this him is Christ. So by Christ all things were created, all the authorities, visible or invisible, all were created by God, by Christ, by him and for him. That means we were created.